we're back to the final session of this wonderful seminar. My name is Patricio Langa, and I'll be chairing this session, and I'm pleased and thankful to Simon for the invitation. Without further delay, I believe we must be tired by now after two long days. So I would immediately introduce my the first speaker and the main presenter, Professor Michael Cross. Professor Michael Cross is a researcher and professor in higher education at the University of Johannesburg in South Africa. He has also served as a member of education evaluation teams in Africa, Europe, and USA. He has been awarded teaching and research fellowships in several institutions, including the Johns Hopkins University and Northwestern University in the US. He was a visiting scholar at Stanford University, Stockholm University, and Jules Verne's University It's quite. I think we all have these brief bios. You can see, but now that he's quite an outstanding scholar. And as I said, without further delay, the stage is yours, Prof.
Thanks, Patricio. I don't know why they have to say all this. All this kind of crap. But anyway, thank you. Thank you. When I was invited to come and talk about quality assurance, it was a real puzzle to me because I couldn't see the reason why I have to talk about quality assurance. I didn't actually write a chapter on quality assurance. My chapter wasn't on quality assurance. And besides that, I knew that the key driver of the process of quality assurance in South Africa is right here. The previous chair, she is the quality assurance woman in South Africa. Not just expert, I'm saying that just to stress the point that she lives quality assurance, not just an expert, that's her life. As a quality assurance expert. So it's really embarrassing. I may be saying things here that, so I just spoke to her that if I say things that may not make sense, please would you rescue me? I went through the book, first of all, trying to see whether I could come out with some sort of a comparative framework across the BRICS countries. And unfortunately, I think it's just one chapter there, and the issue hasn't been dealt with very well in the book. So what I decided to do was actually to focus on one country. But more than that, usual quality assurance will involve different levels. You know, national bodies, quality assurance bodies, and institutional quality assurance units, and then what happens at the program level and the sites where the programs are located. So what I try to do is basically to focus on a particular experience, which for me was so critical in developing the quality assurance system in South Africa. And I think that the lessons emerging from that particular process are very useful in terms of engagement and what's happening in India, Russia, and all other countries. That's what I've decided to do. And in doing so, my main focus would be the first program that was selected and targeted by the Council on Higher Education in South Africa for review. It's interesting that within that range of programs, it was actually the program that I was leading, the program in my division, and the program that I was coordinating in my particular case. You can see the kind of experience that I also had to go through in the process. So that's one to talk about. And what's significant about this is really about the way this particular idea was appropriated by the stakeholders, how it was appropriated by the institutions. And they own it. I'm not saying here that institutions are following the council. I'm saying that that first initiative changed the way we're thinking about quality and quality assurance in South Africa. And that's the point, the main point I'll be making throughout. So in terms of my presentation, I'll just focus on the key strategies, processes, and steps, and lessons, and emerging issues. And I think those emerging issues are real issues for discussion across the different countries. You know, at the time, we're all trained, and Dr. Menon, Curtie, was one of the trainers in the process. One thing she didn't tell us in that process is how to actually make sense of a quality assurance system in a country. They didn't tell us, maybe because they didn't want us to know, maybe because they didn't know, maybe because they just thought that it wasn't relevant. But in looking back at that process, I realized that there are certain issues that are very important in my reflection when we're talking about quality assurance in any country. And those issues are related to the conceptual foundations on the base of which we can make sense of the relations of interest, you know, interests. Because in the quality assurance process, in the process of assessment, interests, power, and power relations play a central role. And I realized, after that, and it was actually after the process, that in looking back, we realized that those issues were playing themselves in a very subtle manner in the process, whether within the team or between the team and the programs and the people involved in running the programs that we're evaluating. And another idea is actually the notion of micropolitics and the idea of stakeholders that we discussed yesterday. And those are so critical, and I'll come back to that later. So I try to make sense of what, program review for re-accreditation, that was the issue that was at stake at the time, is all about. It was in a paper I wrote a couple of years ago, and that's the kind of definition that we gave to that, that it actually entails some sort of systematic examination and assessment of an academic activity by peers with the ultimate goal of helping the reviewed to improve practice and comply with established standards and principles regulating academic work within a given system of accountability. We try to capture all that. And that's what basically what I think happens throughout the whole process of program review. Now, it was actually the task of the Higher Education Quality Committee, which was a permanent subcommittee of the Council on Higher Education in South Africa, and was established after 1995, after the White Paper, after the Higher Education Act of 1997, and was established and put in place. Those, for that particular committee, those were the key tasks: accrediting institutions and programs, national reviews, which is really the central idea for me, because national reviews are critical in a situation of change, a profound change, where the programs, the mission, the vision of institutions, and the programs within the institutions may be compromised. And very often, it is real critical that there's some sort of review of what's going on. And that's what happened at that particular point. The council decided to come with the idea that we need to select a number of programs within institutions, review them, and re-accredit them. It was frightening, I know that. The experience was frightening for program providers. Audits, quality promotion, and capacity building, and other issues in terms of liaising with stakeholders, or relevant stakeholders. Kate spoke about the legacy. I'm not going to spend much time about that, because the the key drivers are related to the legacy, but they are also related to developments related to globalization and the emergence of private providers and all that. All those factors were critical to this particular initiative. She also spoke about the change from the 36 institutions to the 26. She spoke about that. I'm not going to repeat that. But one point I want to stress is that going through the key documents from the national constitution to all those policy documents which are related to quality assurance, higher education policy in general, there are key underlying principles which are provide the framework with which the council had to operate. And those are some of the principles: access, equity, redress, democratizing the whole higher education system, quality, effectiveness, efficiency, academic freedom, autonomy. So those were the underlying principles. So whatever I think was happening at the time, one has to be aware that we're operating within a framework of principles and values. Now, the whole process started by the council entailed basically about the key six steps. The first step, because I'm saying here that this was a process of development. It was like some people say, changing the wheel while driving the car. That was more or less what was happening. It was a process of development of the quality assurance system at the time, but at the same time, implementing whatever was happening. So the first stage was selection of qualified, experienced scholars who to develop the criteria and the minimum standards that were to be used in the review process. The second stage, the teams were organized, arranged, and there was training of teams who would undertake self-evaluation within the institution themselves, and also those who would undertake external review and site visits. The third stage was the development of self-evaluation reports that were submitted to the CHE. The reports were reviewed by the teams and then site visits. It is like standard everywhere, the way you have quality assurance. It's like standard. So, you know, there's no point actually of wasting much time. Then going through the review of the reports, and then they go to the council, and then the next stage, they go to the board of the Higher Education Quality Committee. And that's the accreditation stage until a decision is made. Let me run through this first stage because I'm not real concerned. Now, what's interesting here is that in looking at the programs, if we go through a variety of manuals of quality assurance, you have different kinds of issues that are taken into account. Those are the key issues that were isolated. And I would think the reason why they were isolated is taking into account the framework of principles and values that were informing that particular initiative. So yes, the alignment to the national and the institutional context of the program. Issues of program design and coordination, student recruitment, selection, admission, how that takes place, staffing of the programs, teaching and learning issues, research, supervision of students, student assessment, and issues related to physical infrastructure in the library, student retention and throughput issues, and program reviews, where basically, like, not necessarily standard, but I'll say that most quality assurance criteria will cover some of those issues. Now, the training went through the training process. I also participated in that training, and it was actually to clarify all those issues from the goals of that of national reviews and principles, standards, minimum standards, and the decision that were to be made, the process of self-evaluation, and of course there were also the do's and don'ts, and that was a very critical one. You mustn't socialize too much with the people evaluating, you know, those kinds of issues. In terms of decisions, yes, commend when the program has met, you know, minimum standards, meets minimum standards, needs improvement and does not comply. It's also like standard, but of course there are variations in different quality assurance systems. And then the outcome of the result of the whole process is whether the program would get full accreditation or would be accredited with conditions or not accredited. That basically the three key decisions. At the end of the process, out of the 17 programs that were offered throughout the institutions in the country, 14 were accredited. 4 lost the accreditation, and then 4 just decided to pull out. And you can see the significance of this. About 8 programs were out of the system in the process. So I think it was quite significant. I would say also frightening in some cases. Now, here, that's where I want to focus on, because this is more or less a form of reflection of the process, not necessarily the process, because standard. And I think that one of the issues, which is related to the principles and values that I think we didn't take seriously, or we might have underestimated, was the idea that it is possible to reconcile. It's about dealing with the issue of representativity, to reconcile race, gender, and even the representation of institutions with professional consents. And I know that it happens also when we submit articles for review. In some cases, similar to that. But in this particular case, this was a very difficult issue to address in the process. And I think it still remains the same, because as Kurt was saying, the legacy is still there. You know, the issues, the challenges are still in place. Another issue is peers coming from, privileged institutions, not always as sensitive to the problems where poor institutions operate, not always as sensitive to what scholars in those institutions do. And yes, the way all kinds of, I had to do some interviews in the process, lots of stories and narratives about, some people saying, well, they think they're the best in the country. So here's a chance to actually deal with that issue. And another one is the issue of the micropolitics. Taking into account the diversity of the teams coming from institutions that were within a hierarchy around race and ethnicity. So in the teams, the micropolitics played out very often in a very negative manner, either through silence, either through voice. So those are the issues, I think, that we still have to grapple with in the future. So in positions emerging throughout the process, those were, I had here my colleague, Patricia, asking, where are the disciplines? So one of the issues that we're actually asked is, where's the discipline? We're talking about professional programs. What's the role of the discipline in a professional program? Those kinds of questions, which is not a very simple question to address. And those who are much more inclined towards innovation, of course, they would focus more on skills, skills-oriented strategies. They would focus more on problem-solving emphasis. So that's the kind of divide that we saw throughout the process. And of course, with globalization and the changing nature of labor, of course, the issues of flexibility of labor, alignment with the labor market, those kinds of issues were also raised. And there was the issue of transformation too. I think one of the interesting ones here about, because programs on educational leadership and management tend to be the same across different countries, in a sense, in terms of international approach, they tend to be more or less similar to that. So we're lagging far behind compared to the world out there It's time that we learn to live on planet Earth rather than living in isolation. So there was that kind of, it's better to keep the norm across the countries. But another challenge really is something that you could even see it here throughout our discussions, is the profiles of the participants and also the kinds of epistemological approach they had to quality assurance, to quality and quality assurance. And it's another domain which is very difficult. I mean, I was thinking here myself, I said, what? We had a narrative of facts and we had a narrative of meaning. Not always the narrative of fact and meaning were talking to each other in the process. And that's the same thing that was happening in that particular process, that people had different approaches to educational leadership and management. And of course, what happens in that process is that certain positions have to prevail in the process. But I think that what's pleasing is real where everybody seems to converge. And that was around the idea of academic excellence and international standards. That across, people were concerned with that. I'm having a problem with the time. There were also methodological issues, but methodological issues, those emerged out of the teams themselves. And that's the point I was talking about the composition of the teams. Given the issues of the tension between representativity and professional concerns, so some of the reports would suffer from those kinds of shortcomings. That, you know, here's one of the responses from one of the institutions reading the report and quoting those kinds of phrases. There seems to be, there does not seem, but the underlying principle is that any claim being made should be based on evidence and not that kind of a speculative approach. Now, what are the lessons emerging from this? I think that one of the lessons is that the process of quality assurance, given the complexity, involves a great deal of intellectual compromise to be made, but not just that. Political and ethical compromises. And that's one thing that we have to deal with in the process. Another critical lesson is that quality assurance usually is a domain that tends to be dealt with from a more technicist approach. And what we've learned from the process is that we needed to move beyond that. We needed to move beyond the paper and pencil approach. And finally, one of the issues is, well, that remains. That remains, which is the mix between the professional and academic, theory and practice. The CHE produced a State of the Nation report where they summarized the experience and they came out with the position of the CHE. And I think that what's interesting in response to some of those issues was the need to balance theory and practice, even if we're dealing with the professional programs. The second point that comes from that particular document was that programs should reflect the mission and the identity of the institution. So they were opening space for more diverse approach to programs. There was also an issue of how to deal with some of the challenges there, that perhaps a way of addressing the issues should be an environment that promotes social inquiry. Research is critical to the process, and that was a very important point made by the CHE. But there are lots of unexplored questions, and I'm sure I was just involved in a quality assurance review in some other countries. I don't have to mention here. And the issues are similar. We face with similar questions in all those cases. How should quality control bodies including the CHE in the case of South Africa, respond to the growing contestation around peer review in the program accreditation? How to deal with that? I know that the CHE actually tried to deal with this issue, perhaps the best way possible, engagement of scholars. So this was a stakeholder, in a sense, a stakeholder-driven process. And what I mean by stakeholders here is that it gave primacy to peers in the process. And that's what perhaps what seems to be a unique feature of this particular process. How do we reconcile the tension between stakeholders and professional concerns? Now, that's the issue that was raised yesterday, but I think it remains, the question is still there. How do we deal with that? Because it's part of the politics of quality assurance. And how do we resolve productively the epistemological battles around assessment? You know, I guess we'd have the same model here. We could do surveys, for example. Or we could use a different approach, or could have a mixed method in the process. But again, it reflects the epistemology, the competing epistemologies that we work with. And the issue that was discussed yesterday, which is about, the canon, established modes of practice and innovation. How do we bring those two together? It is also another issue that remains, especially in a situation of profound change that we're going through. So in conclusion, what I'll say, I mean, that's my belief, that it was the degree of professionalization of the CHE, the way it dealt with these issues, that made the task easier. The CHE was not trying to do what academics do. They were facilitating, coordinating, and facilitating the process. And peers were doing the assessment. And I think that particular dimension is critical. And I'm saying this just by looking at other forms of assessment in other countries. The second point is the involvement of peers in the process of stakeholders. It was so critical. And I guess it's related to the next point, that really perhaps is not the fact that some of the programs were accredited. It is the individual and organizational learning emanating from that particular exercise. Because it's an idea that was appropriated. And I'm saying that even out of our own experience in my own department. That's what we learn in the process. We appropriate the idea, and we just ran away with it. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Actually, the rejoinder, Maria Helena Magalhães de Castro. Maria de Magalhães Castro. Maria Helena is a professor of the Department of Sociology at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. She holds a PhD in political science from the Department of Political Science at Duke University. And you can also find more about her in this small leaflet that is available out there, and I'm sure in your bags as well. Maria Helena, the floor is yours. Thank you.
I'm very, very pleased with the invitation and the unplanned but very interesting web trip I did to South African recent history, because my work was to read and reread your chapter in the book and comment on it. But there will be issues of quality assurance at the end while discussing this, the behavior of the state there. So I think it's going to be useful anyway. I'm even more honored by the challenge of commenting on Michael Cross' updated writing because he's a senior expert and a protagonist in many events of the history he writes about. I'm delighted to see Patricio again. I found out that you spent at least 5 to 6 years in South Africa doing graduate school work in the best university of West Cape and then postdoc research in a former colored university, and I know that you are still there. The point of the chapter is the role of the state, specifically whether or not the changes in the modes of state coordination of higher education are legitimate or, on the contrary, are violating constitutional entitlements such as to institutional autonomy and even academic freedom in some situations. The new national vision for higher education in South Africa that was prescribed in the Higher Education Act of 1997 integrated the higher education as one single system and was underpinned by three features. The first, increased participation, meaning expansion of students' enrollments, guided by the principles of equity and redress. Redress meaning put it right, compensate. The second was greater responsiveness, and I'll go back to this. And the third was increased cooperation and partnerships. The idea was also to assure institutional autonomy and academic freedom to all South African higher education institutions and to adopt a shared governance regime, which would leave to the state remote administration powers, a steering role. The idea behind state supervision or steering was to create a policy environment in which institutions are able to respond and address national priorities from the vantage point of their institutional context through making clear the goals and principles of a higher education system. So proactive institutions. Dr. Cross, the transition in South Africa was well conceptualized by the author as a transplacement process, as opposed to regime overthrown or regime replacement. It was a very remarkable process for being able to negotiate the transfer of power from the old regime to the forces of opposition based on compromise on both sides that safeguarded fundamental continuities across the established organs of state and existing social structures that would require systematic transformation later. These continuities were felt as a web of constraints by the new government, which faced the contradictory role as the custodian of the continuities secured by the transitional constitutional arrangements, and on the other hand, as this instrument for breaking with this very legacy through socio-economic and political transformation and for building a new democratic state. It took successive legislative amendments and the creation of several statutory bodies to implement the new higher education vision. In this process, the government acquired considerable muscle to tackle several transformation and policy implementation matters, including the institutional mergers, the new funding formula, and quality control systems. So, widening this picture, because the chapter covers that, we find the government facing dilemmas on other fronts too. The new vision for higher education was more or less in tune with the larger reconstruction and development program, the RDP, which emphasized the first feature of the vision, expansion and massification of higher education. The dilemma here was that these goals were to be achieved under the growth, employment, and redistribution macroeconomic framework that demanded greater fiscal discipline, including social contract based on salary restraints to protect and create employment, as well as many limits to on public expenditures. Under these circumstances, questions of rationalization, efficiency, and educational performance became more pressing than ever. This environment created an increasing realization that for institutions to meet these challenges successfully, they had to engage in a whole new game, a paradigm shift. This was approached in different ways, from developing a strong and visionary entrepreneurial leadership change the character of faculty to injecting a business approach to university work. This kind of neoliberal globalized drives collided with the democratic values of equity and cooperation of the new vision. So I'll move to the PowerPoint because it will help me to be more effective. So what we see here is a very different approach from what we learned from Kirti. But I'll go ahead and then we discuss. So I think everybody knows that under the apartheid era, the system was like this. What is interesting to see is how many authorities are there. It's the first column. There were four republics. So the system was fragmented along many departments with the authorities and then very different regimes. So the administration was like, for the four English universities, they were considered open university and reject any form of government interference in institutional affairs, and they emerged a liberal university which posed some challenges to the apartheid policies. The five African universities occupied a unique space, enjoyed a special status within the apartheid, and as a part of the official state ideological apparatus, they enjoyed similar freedom. In contrast, the six homeland universities were designed as extensions of the Bantustan, which were the lands assigned to ethnic nations, would be language, to the Bantustan bureaucracies. The 1959 Act, which established these institutions, gave the state absolute powers and control over them in determining through legislation whom to admit, whom to teach, and what to teach. The state here is the local state, is the Bantustan the state, it's not the central state. The central state, okay. In other words, institutional autonomy and academic freedom were permissible insofar as they were not in conflict with the state policy and ideology. So it was very different. Private education wasn't relevant in Professor Cross's state power equation. And Kirti also corroborated this. The data that I found in the chapter is this, that it grew a lot, but it's concentrated in further education and training and does not pose any significant competition to the public sector. I got curious if you have international providers, if you have any kind of legislation to deal with them. The new regulatory framework gave the minister powers to decide policy for public and private higher education institutions, establish an advisory body, the CHE that we heard about, and its branch, which is the Higher Education Quality Committee for Quality Control. And the interesting thing is that all the advices the CHE gave to the minister had to be published, regardless if the minister adopted or not. I found it interesting. The third feature is that all higher education institutions were turned into universities and had legal powers to award degrees once accredited by the Higher Education Quality Committee. And finally, for institutional governance, each public institution should have a vice chancellor who is the CEO of a council, a senate, an institution forum, as well as student representative council. The council was given the power to govern the university and make all appointments, some of which could be delegated. At least 60% of its composition includes individuals who are not university staff or students. I didn't get this. Were they professors, external stakeholders? That's interesting. That's very nice. In the public institutions found themselves in very, very unequal conditions to respond to the new vision. The new vision merged the 36 institutions into 23, creating three kinds of universities. The reduction of the number of institutions did not compromise the number of delivery sites, which is interesting. And the English-speaking traditional universities, they were not affected by the mergers, so they continue to do their own business. What they did is to take larger numbers of non-traditional students and face the challenge of getting more aid and extra academic support for them. The Afrikaners took advantage from two traditions, large autonomy and a centralized management, to rapidly adapt to managerialism and move towards the entrepreneurial university profile. The non-white segment was the most affected by mergers and constituted a very low base in terms of all kinds of resources to respond to the requirements. 2011-12, five of them were under some kind of intervention due to malfunctioning. So now we enter in the points that Professor Cross in the chapters present as evidence of the change of behavior of the government, like from benign steering powers to strong steering powers. So one argument he uses the adoption of standardization as a measure of quality, combined with an outcome-based philosophy for funding research and institutions, as well as for accrediting programs and qualifications. And this was done by different means, but one of these was these standards that you just presented. I read them and I said, what's wrong with them? They're open-ended, relevant dimensions, and they are almost the same I found in the New England Association of Schools and Colleges in their document for self-studies. A second argument to use is that the new funding formula, which is essentially a goal-oriented performance-related funding framework, with the danger of prioritizing quantity outputs and not sufficiently being able to monitor the quality of those outputs. The planning cycle consists of assessment of the performance of institutions against their goals and targets set in their institutional plans approved by the Minister of Education. Again, this is a regular way of funding higher education across the world. So we have global standards there. The third is the induction through funding for more engineering and science programs. Same in Brazil. We need more of these too. Fourth, the top-down manner in which the merger of institutions was implemented, which I found not good, sometimes inevitable, so you don't give more information for us to see how the government, what the government was doing there. The fifth is the acquisition of powers to intervene in malfunctioning institutions, for appointing administrators, forbidding taking loans, and building new infrastructure. Well, acquisition of power to intervene in malfunctioning institutions seems sensible, but there are ways and ways of doing so. Control loans and expenses seem sensible too. As the minister said, the Minister of Education said in 2004, we cannot stand by while institutions collapse. What is wrong there would be a better alternative for this. So we have institutions not able to survive. Six, the accreditation process through which the qualifications get approval is driven by the Higher Education Quality Committee, assisted by faceless reviewers recruited from various universities. We just heard here that these peers come from the best universities, and they don't have sensitivity to deal with the poor institutions. I found a very bad idea to have faceless reviewers, because the point of this kind of accreditation is to exchange, to build trust, to exchange first-hand experience, and to sustain improvement. I don't know, you have three kinds of exit from your accreditation, full accreditation, half, and no accreditation. In the United States, everybody gets accredited. Nobody gets out. You don't destroy a higher education institution. You give them a larger period to come back. If it's a very good, you come back in 10 years. If you're bad, you come back next month, in a semester. And everybody comes out with an agenda of improvements to accomplish with the overview, oversight of the peer committee that visit you. So this is a way to use evaluation to improve quality, to build quality, but to build trust, cooperation. So maybe the training of your peers were not good enough. We have to develop more the sensitivity to the whole institution. The seventh point was that the mandatory registration of qualifications, which is a bureaucratic requirement, enforced compliance with the South African Quality Authority National Qualification Framework, and with its outcome-based philosophy in curriculum structuring. I mean, so you have to register the qualifications that were accredited, and then you were forced to do this. You had to be, before that, follow with the National Qualification Framework that adopt an outcome-based philosophy, which you find not good. Then your tests say that the increasing pressure for external control over academic program development through the new national accreditation schemes constrain the ability of faculties to decide on curriculum issues. They are now required to review their programs and curriculum and align them with the national policy framework. Program accreditations and concerns with standards may be interpreted as an invitation for more integration and coherence across the system. They also reflect the complex ways in which the relationship between the state and academia has been redefined and reorganized to the disadvantage of the latter, particularly at the level of curriculum practice. Now, I talked to Simone. Simone doesn't agree completely with me. But from my perspective, the main way to define a curriculum is by defining the kind of graduate you want. I want to form here this kind of person, a researcher or a professional. And from this profile, then you develop the curriculum. So I don't see any problem with this outcome-based philosophy. For me, there are other ways to define curriculum, but I write there that the violation of academic freedom would require no participation in the national qualification framework definitions and the impossibility of going beyond the minimum ground defined by the CHE. Because my question is that who defined the national qualifications framework? Wasn't the own academic community or bureaucrats? Usually these kind of documents, they are product of the own academia. So I ask if this matter couldn't be tackled within the academic community in each subject areas and maybe try consensus there. The last one is the demands of information that exhausted the institutions. Institutions are totally overstretched and in their efforts to respond to the many issues raised by the national plan, the new funding framework, the new planning regime for institutions, the Higher Education Quality Committee, and the South African Qualifications Authority. South African higher education is in severe danger of suffering from alarming levels of system overload. Happens here in Brazil. The fundamental, the primary school systems lives this situation, filled with forms to fill. But here, what I like to say is that these demands for data, exhausting haste, institutions can be turned into a very positive and a key asset for the institution. The development of an institutional brain division, which I saw in a university in Chile. It was a small team, very good in IT, in technology, and in doing research. They consolidated all the data from the institution in this thing. They were the only ones to send information to government to guarantee consistency of information sent out. And they would assist the council and research their own university. They were studying problems and doing research internally. And also publicizing for external and internal stakeholders the information needed. So it's a very nice, so we better learn what to do with this information because we need them. Thank you.
I think we can now open the floor for some questions and comments. Surely the issues that were raised here, they don't just apply to the South African case. Quality assurance and assessment has become a global issue, but of course with national and local realities playing its, you know, a particular role. So the floor is open for questions and comments.
I'm just thinking that the way you do it in South Africa, all the discussion is very different from the way it's done in Brazil. And Brazil has a kind of system in which you measure the achievement of these programs through tests the students have to go through. So if the students are doing well at the end of the course, then supposedly the institution is well qualified. If students are doing poorly, it's not well qualified. Then you add other information, you create some indexes. Some numbers you get, and then you have a hierarchy of institutions according to the grade they get in this kind of measure. But the key element is this assessment that students have to do. So it's an interesting thing. But my point is that what's common in the two systems is that it seems that you have just one standard. So if you have this, we had all the discussion of differentiation before, and if you are talking about a differentiated system, you should have different standards for different kinds of institutions. And I wonder if in the case of South Africa, this kind of external review that you do, you have to take into account whether you are dealing with a top kind of institution doing more advanced research and teaching, if you're doing with a comprehensive college or different kind of institutions, and if you apply different standards and defining different goals. What's the goal of the institution? Actually, in the Brazilian system, although I don't think it works very well, supposedly the institution, they have to make a self-assessment first and say what is their own project, what they think that they should do, and then you assess them in terms of if they are doing what they say they should do, assuming, of course, that they do something relevant. But if I agree that this is what they want to do and they can do it properly, they believe that this is their mission or their vocation, then of course you assess them on that on those grounds, not on other grounds. But basically, at the end, I think the tendency, which we have discussed here, of academic drift, everybody wants to be a university, everybody wants to be at the top level, you apply a very high standards, and you end up with a very difficult situation. In the case of Brazil, again, you apply the standards of research universities to require people to have academic publications, you have to have full-time PhDs, et cetera, et cetera. And when you apply this to a teaching institution, then, of course, they came out very, very badly. And so there is a problem there of adjusting the assessment to the vocation of the different missions of the different institutions.
Thank you, Simon. We can take maybe two more.
I think my questions are as much for clarification as anything. We have a very highly developed system of reviews, so I come from that and I ask my questions in relation to that. How are the peers chosen? Because that is pretty crucial, I would think. It also plays back into your question of different kinds of standards for different types of institution. You need to have peers from similar kinds of institutions, or you know, they'll tell you you're not Harvard or something when you, you know, didn't try to be. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of important to have the right peers. So that brings the question of how are they chosen. Also, what we also find in Canada, which is of course a smaller country, you know, everybody kind of knows everybody else, and so it's complicated in some of the smaller disciplines, or anyway, to find people who are at arm's length, so it can be quite complicated. Also, how frequently are reviews done? I mean, presumably it's not once in a lifetime, it presumably has some kind of a cycle. And is there anything that would trigger a review sooner? So, for example, a sufficient set of new programs or changed circumstances of some sort. And then when you have the outcomes of the review, and Professor Cross listed those, I mean, is that kind of the final word? I mean, supposing it's that the program should be discontinued, okay, fine, then that's it? I mean, how do you maybe bring something back? And also, one of the things that we struggle with is that there are certain programs that, in a way, you just can't discontinue. It's not possible to have a comprehensive university, for example, that doesn't, you know, teach mathematics or something. So you can't discontinue, you know, or what does it mean to discontinue? It doesn't mean you have to discontinue the major, but maybe you can still have service courses, you know, these kinds of things. So there must be some kind of nuances about that discontinuing, because otherwise some very strange things could actually result.
Yes. Okay. Any further questions? No. Okay. I think you can tackle. You actually, the second is, she actually raised about four questions, so we have enough to.
I'm not sure whether I actually understood
the question that you asked. But you are referring to evidence, the kinds of evidence, and how in Brazil you have perhaps, I don't know, more comprehensive in terms of a more quantified survey. That's what you're saying. Yeah. You know, it's. I would say it's actually similar. I didn't actually unpack the dimension of evidence which is required. So. Yes, there's a process of development of a self-evaluation report. And it includes all kinds of evidence that the institution has got to demonstrate that they meet minimum standards. In that case, could be from evidence related to the program. They can actually even do some surveys. Surveys with the students. They could look at throughput. Like when it comes to students, for example, data related to throughput, data related to forms of assessment, data related to even program reviews that they've done themselves. So it's quite a wide range of data, of evidence that has to be produced to demonstrate that. And the reviewers also look at the kind of data that has been provided, of evidence that has been provided. So I don't see much difference in terms of the actual evidence being required. How are peers chosen? Well, I remember that in some recent reviews, one of the issues that we actually mentioned and suggest is that the process should be more transparent. But we are talking here about the situation, they mentioned that, where the pool of people who are qualified to undertake those kinds of reviews are basically well-known, widely known.
Respected and well-reputed.
Yes, at the same time. I guess it made it the task of the council easier. If you ask myself, how did it happen? Is that, a message was sent to the institution saying we need the reviewers. And they had to volunteer. Now, what I've seen is that you actually have to apply. That's the requirement they have. You have to apply, and you have to actually demonstrate that you qualified. I just read it last night. You have to apply, you have to demonstrate that you're qualified to undertake some of those reviews. You're familiar with the process. Of course, you go through training. Now, I don't know. Katie, you could step in here and...
United States, where I study, the peers are chosen.
Can you please use the mic?
Based on the self-study the agency received. Mm. So they choose, they put up a committee that has the profile of the problems that institutions are presenting, because they are supposed to present problems and things that they want to solve and improve. So it's very well chosen and put up, the team. In Brazil, it's a random thing. They just make a sortear. Huh?
Right.
It's a lottery. Yes, the peers are, yeah, INEP was doing as a lottery. So how frequent are reviewers in Brazil? Usually 5 years, but what triggers a review, it's a new program, you need to authorize, and then 3 years later you have to recognize it as a good one. The same with a new institution. And if you have a bad grade, 3 years in sequence in the exams that we have, you also are visited by the ministry. He sent the people there. Discontinued programs. I think it's a horrible thing, but in Brazil they do that. They close, the program cannot take new students, and the students that are there, depending on the situation, are moved to another institution. It's a mess. We come to this situation at which I don't approve at all. I think it's horrible. And the last thing that I forgot to say is that accreditation and evaluation is a very not tangible knowledge. I mean, the countries try and try. So I had some other things here. I wanted to show this very history in the UK. Nick Harris was in Brazil in 2005, and he was the director of development and enhancement of the quality agency there. So he had to meet change expectation, moving from implicit trust to explicit explanation of as the basis of trust. Consensus is not easy. Yeah. Building a sustainable quality culture, in UK, coming from confrontation, maybe to collaboration. He has this. From 89 to 2002, at institutional level, they have this teaching quality assessment. At the subject level, they have also reviews. In 97, the Deering report changed and turned things even more measurable and quantitative. In 5 years later, the university rebelled. The CEO of the agency resigns. And a new method, a new approach is tried. This new approach kept a little bit of the Deering recommendations and referred this to the academic infrastructure. And the new part, it was an agreement to audit universities using academic peers, not professional inspectorates, and by its academic standards, of the institution standards, the quality of the provision of their courses. So they became more relative to the mission of the institution. Mm-hmm. The principles were to put the responsibility on assuring quality within the institutions, to place certain specific obligations on institutions, and require institutions to publish full, accurate, and verifiable information about quality and standards for students. And then he says, like, it's just a new agenda. It's not about uniformity or setting in stone. It's like, it's a process, yeah. Unpredictable path. You just have to go and then change and building consensus to move on. Mm. And usually it starts in quantitative way. In Europe, usually the first thing you do is to get to guard the data to measure. And then the academia rebels, and then you start doing something different.
Mm. Hi, I was just going to respond on the selection process of peer reviews, peer reviewers. Firstly, there would be a call to the universities. And secondly, we would have set up criteria against which we would select reviewers. The process was also developmental. So if you had a panel of five people reviewing a particular qualification, unlike this is not a subject review, but rather a qualification review. If you had a panel of five, and it was, for example, the example that Michael used, which was the master's degree, you would have research active reviewers, but you might add one reviewer who is an emerging researcher, not established as yet, in order to use it as a developmental opportunity. So that's the kind of process. Yeah. And the second issue around closing of programs, the closure of programs was always linked to the question, is the program so bad that it cannot be fixed in 3 to 6 months? If the answer to that was yes, it could not be fixed, or no, it could not be fixed, then if the program was to be closed, then arrangements would be made for students to be transferred to other programs. And then the institution would be given like a 3-year period when they could not offer, and it would take them another 3 to 5 years before they could apply to reinstate a new program with that qualification title.
Take a second round.
I just want to share one thing in China and also get your feedback. We all know China is good at testing, right? If you have that knowledge, you won't be surprised. Maybe we can call China now as an evaluative regime. So lots of these kind of auditing evaluation programs, which could lead to the similar consequence you just talked about. But there's one thing in China, which is they give you a warning, right? If you really cannot meet up the standards, the government won't shut you off right away. They give you 1 year or maybe 2 years for you to collect yourself and try to meet up the standards. So do you have this kind of the practice in South Africa or Brazil?
Well, it's a comment, isn't it?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes. Is it better? Okay. I just want to share my experience in China. You know, as a consequence of the evaluation or assessment, if you don't meet up the standards, you could be closed down. But in that case, institution or program will be given 1 or 2 years as a transitional stage. If you, through your efforts, you can, you know, meet up standards, then you can escape that kind of consequence. So I'm wondering whether this is a similar practice in South Africa or Brazil.
Well, in our case, I can use my own example. There was a dimension of the program that was problematic. So we're given 6 months and present an improvement plan to fix it, which is what we did. And then the problem was solved.
My answer would be like, in Brazil, they do give a period, but I'm not sure, Renato, for
It happens with the private sector, within the
Probation period.
Yeah.
And then there's
but
a review.
But it's a one-year probation.
Yeah, it's a one-year, yeah. Then there's a review.
What I didn't mention, I would like to mention for South Africa too, is the lack of enabling conditions. The government should help institutions to get better, like have grants for hiring consultants, professional consultants, or TI folks to organize the data. No, they need support. In Europe, they did have support in the reform from, because they were completely academic, no management. When they started to have their own management, they have support to professionalize the management. So if we want the institutions to move and to do, you have to enable them. I think this evaluation process of the visit peers and it build trust and then you exchange experiences, one way of enabling, but some money would be nice to.
Well, I think with if this do you want to add anything more, or we can just start wrapping up. Yes, yeah. I want to thank again my two the two presenters and Simon also for this opportunity to chair this session. I'm sure there's a lot that can be discussed on this topic. I just maybe a comment. I for the last 4 years I was the director of external evaluation in Mozambique. And I faced some of these dilemmas myself trying to implement the quality assurance system in the country. Yes, as I said, there are global trends, but also very peculiar, very specific challenges that each country faces when it comes to this. But of course, just like some other key features in higher education, you can't just avoid it. Quality assurance is there, just like other forms of accountability that we can't really escape them. So thank you, and I'd like to ask for an applause for my round of applause for them. Thank you.